A very good evening to all of you. Is the video and audio proper? Okay, thank you, Shivangi. A very good evening to all of you. I will start the class within 2 more minutes. So, today you had a test on social issues and one essay. I hope you all must have completed it. And earlier we used to have an off on Sunday, but now we are having an off on Saturday, so that you can get time to revise for the test. So today we will begin with the geography. I will be telling you what all topics we are going to cover, and then we will. This is going to be comprehensive for prelims and mains. So I'll just wait for another 1 minute, and then we will begin. So now we are beginning with the class. So see, geography is basically the study of two things. One is the physical features of the earth, and other is the physical human activity, which is affected by the physical features or the effect on the of the human activities on the physical features of the earth. So human activity, which affects and is affected by physical features, include distribution of population, distribution of resources, economic activities, and changes in the environment. So when you will look at the UPSC syllabus, all of these things, not only the physical distribution of resources, not only geography, physical geography, the solar system, the universe, but also they have issues which affect the location of industries. So all of these factors are covered in your UPSC syllabus, and this is evident by the definition of geography. And now you can basically understand much better as to how your syllabus is defined and how your definition of geography is. So it is divided into two main branches. One is the physical geography. So it will deal with the processes and patterns in the environment, like atmosphere, hydrosphere, biosphere, and geosphere. Atmosphere means the air, basically, and hydrosphere means water, biosphere means all the life, and geosphere is basically the element of earth which is there. Now, human geography deals with the environment shaped by human activity. So physical geography can be divided into subfields, that is geomorphology, climatology, meteorology, oceanography, hydrology, and biogeography and environmental geography. So all of these things we will be studying in detail. So today we are going to study geomorphology, which means the science which is understanding the surface of the earth and the process by which it is shaped. So the main thing which we are going to study today is how the earth is shaped, how it is the way it is, how various mountains develop, how various valleys develop, and why do we have the oceans where they are, why is India situated here. So all of these things we are going to study. Apart from this, when you study it, you will gather a better understanding of the whole subject, and you will better understand as to why which minerals and which resources are located at which place. So this is the whole introduction of the subject. So now we will begin with the basic part which you have to study. Now see, basically that advantage which you will be having in this course is that all of the things which are there in this notes, they are made from 6 to 12 NCRTs, and all the important sources which you will realize with time that it has covered everything. So first we have the interior of the earth. Now why is it important? So basically it is important to understand how the earth's surface became as it is today. So physical geography and geomorphology, we are dealing with why is the shape of the earth as it is now. So it is important because we get to know why the surface of the earth is as it is today and what changes can be there in the shape tomorrow. So it is essential because to understand the earth's surface, to understand various phenomena like volcanism, earthquake, earth's magnetic field. See, basically earth's magnetic field is not only important for your human life, but it is also important for all the communication systems which you have. It also protects you from the harmful radiations in the environment, in the atmosphere and the upper atmosphere, in the space. So we will understand its significance in the coming notes. And when we know the interior of the earth, then we can also know the internal structure of various solar system objects. The reason being that all of the universe has evolved from a singular thing. We will study the nebular hypothesis of, regarding the origin of the universe. In that we will come to know that it was all a revolving gas mass. So everything in the universe has emerged from that. And if we know the internal structure of one unit in the solar system or in the universe, we can also study the other objects as well, because the source is same, so we can find out what changes could be there in the solar system. Now to understand the composition of the atmosphere and for mineral exploration. So because you know that coal, iron, petroleum, all of those are found within the surface of the earth, also uranium, radium, all nuclear, basically what radioactive substances or whatever kind of metals, non-metals, whatever resources you need are coming from within the earth. So if we have a better understanding of the interior of the earth, don't you think it would be better if we study the earth and then start digging up for resources, rather than taking up the equipment and digging everywhere on the planet and making it a useless exercise? So if you study the interior of the earth, you will understand all of these things. Now earth's surface. Now many processes shape the surface of the earth, and the forces come from both above and beneath the earth's surface. So basically what it is trying to say is that we are living on the land, and the shape of the earth is shaped by many processes. Some processes are coming from below, means the major force of that, the underlying force of that process is coming from beneath the earth. So whenever you see that there is a volcano which is erupting or earthquake which is taking place, we all have a basic understanding that the earthquake or the volcano, the disturbance starts from below the earth. It does not happen that something happens above the earth, it flows downwards and then something happens. So that is not the correct scientific understanding of the things. The real thing is that some disturbance takes place within the earth, below the surface of the earth, and then it comes out. So the processes that are caused by the forces from within the earth are called as endogenous processes. Endo means in. So those processes which are born within the surface of the earth are called endogenous processes, and those which occur from outside the earth. So basically, if very fast wind is blowing and it is changing the way how the landscape is there on the surface of the earth. For example, a very strong water flow is there, flow of water is there, and it is cutting across the vegetation. So that will be known as exogenous process because it is coming from above the earth. Now the major things like mountains, plateaus or lakes are result of endogenous forces. So basically those forces which come from within the earth may cause extremely significant changes in the structure of the earth. So in the structure of the earth, the main forces which are responsible for bringing about the change in the structure of the earth are those which come from within the earth. These are endogenous processes. What happens after this is folding, faulting, and these are driven from forces inside the earth. We will see what is folding and faulting in detail. We are going to see everything in detail. Now what happens in a volcano or earthquake? The forces that cause catastrophic events like earthquake and volcanoes come from deep below the earth's surface. So that is also endogenous. For example, earthquake occurred due to the movement of tectonic plates, and the energy required is supplied by convectional currents in the mantle. So we will see exactly what is going on in a few more pages. You will understand what exactly happens. So basically there is a layering of the earth. So the innermost part is known as the core, the middle part is known as the mantle, and the uppermost part is known as the crust. So in the mantle, which is the middle part of the earth, we will see it with the help of diagrams as well. So I'll explain it at that time, but you just understand that there is a molten portion in the mantle, and there are convectional currents. Convectional currents means there is some movement. For right now, for those who are beginning, you can just understand that there is movement in the mantle, and that creates the force to move the plates with which the earth is made, and that creates a volcano or an earthquake. Volcano occurs through vents and fissures created by tectonic movements. So we will be dealing with this. And if you have any doubts, you can simultaneously ask me on the chat. So Earth's magnetic field. The reason for Earth's magnetic field is the convection currents in the outer core of the Earth. So basically, you have to understand this difference, that the volcanoes and earthquake are taking because convectional current in the mantle, and Earth's magnetic field is formed due to the convection current in the outer core. Life on Earth would not have been possible if not for the Earth's magnetic field, which protects from the harmful solar wind. So basically, even though the sun is very far away from the earth, but it is able to send, there are some storms which take place in the sun. It is known as a solar storm, and its effect is so much, the radiations are so harmful that they can reach the earth as well. So had not the magnetic field of the earth been there, we would not have been alive. Life would have not been there as we know it today. Now, internal structure of various solar system objects. So we were seeing how the study will help us to how the internal study of internal of the earth, internal structure of the earth, will help us in knowing the solar system objects. So the entire solar system was formed from a single nebular cloud. As I told you in the beginning, that everything in the universe has come out from a single nebular cloud, and the process of every solar system is believed to be similar as that of the earth. So basically, throughout the universe or in the solar system, we can see that there was a cloud of gas. It rapidly cooled down and it formed the planets as we know today. So there will be difference in the distance from the sun, the temperature, otherwise everything is the same in their formation. So we can take that as an underlying commonality and understand why these things happened as such. Evolution and present composition of the atmosphere. Now, for life to flourish on the surface of the earth, the atmosphere needs to have essential components like oxygen, carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases to maintain the temperature on the surface, and ozone to protect from the ultraviolet radiation, and the right atmospheric pressure. So basically, when you will study the internal of the earth, you will also develop a appreciation. See, there are so many things required for human life to thrive on this planet. and all of them are available on Earth. See, it is such a rare combination that it is not found on any other planet in the solar system. So how all of these situations combine together and form such a combination? So all of these components owe their existence to volcanic eruptions that unlock them from the Earth's interior. So all of this oxygen, carbon dioxide, most of the gases which you are breathing today have come from the interior of the Earth. So this is also extremely important. And mineral exploration, understanding volcanic activity and the nature of rocks is essential for mineral exploration. So basically most of the minerals which are economically important for man today are found in the rocks. We take them out from the rocks. So we should have a proper study of the rocks and all of the so that we can better know from where we have to take out the resource. So most of the minerals like diamonds that occur in the Earth's surfaces are formed deep below the Earth's surfaces. They are brought to the surface by volcanic activity. So we need to be very sure as to how and where we can find these resources. Otherwise, we might be spending a lot of money and time and energy and not finding anything else. Now, we have studied that why it is important to study the internal structure of the Earth. So, secondly, what we will be studying now is sources of information. See, now the sources of information regarding the information of the internal structure of Earth can be two types. One can be direct or other can be indirect. Direct means that you are going in the interior of the Earth directly, and then other sources can be indirect. We will be using waves or some modern technology with the help of which we will know about the interior structure of the Earth. So this chapter is extremely important for you. It can be asked directly in the mains or in the prelims as well. So directly in the mains, it means verbatim. It is nothing to understand. If you just learn all of these terms, you will be getting full marks. Now, deep earth mining and drilling reveal the nature of rocks. So basically, if you drill or if you dig and go under the beneath the surface of the Earth, you are going to get direct information of what is the interior of the Earth made of. But they are not possible beyond a certain depth. They do not reveal much information about the Earth's interior. So basically, you will see that only hardly 1% of the Earth we can dig and go inside. Rest of the information we have to find out through other means. So, but what kind of information we have found due to these things? First is the Mopeng gold mine. It is the deepest mine in the world. So basically, this and Tau Kona gold mine is the second deepest mine in the world in South Africa. Are the deepest mines reaching only 3.9 km. So basically the radius of the Earth is I think around 6400 km and this is only 3.9 km. And the deepest drilling point is only about 12 km deep, bored by the Soviet Union in 1970s over the Kola Peninsula. So this is the place, Kola Peninsula. See, all of these things are just mentioned in the NCRT that the deepest mine in the world is in South Africa. So this is the exact name. Whenever such a reference has been made in the old NCRTs, we have seen in the prelims that some kind of questions are asked regarding them. So you can look at it from here and remember these terms. And this is the deepest drill, which is only 12 km. So if you see that a majority of the Earth is still not discovered with the help of direct sources. Volcanic eruption is also another source of obtaining direct information. So basically what happens is that when a volcano is erupted, things from the interior of the Earth come out. So that also tells us that the interior of the Earth is hot, what kind of rocks there are, when they will solidify, when the lava, molten lava will solidify, we will get rocks. So we can understand that these are the same rocks which are there in the interior of the Earth. Now, indirect sources of information about the interior. Now, gravitation and the diameter of the Earth help in estimating the pressure depth inside, pressure deep inside. So there are scientific formulas with the help of which you can find out the pressure inside the Earth with the help of So basically, if you will have taken physics in class 11th and 12th, you would be knowing the formula exactly, which is not required here. Okay, we just have to know that diameter of the earth and the gravitation help in telling us the pressure inside. So this is the first indirect source, because we know the value of gravitation and we know the diameter of the earth, so we can find out what is the pressure at what point. Then volcanic eruptions and existence of hot springs point out that the interior is very hot. As I told you above also, that directly what we can find out from the volcanic eruption is that it is what kind of material is there inside. But what we can find out indirectly is that because the lava is coming out very hot, so we have a basic understanding that the interior of the earth would be very hot. So this is kind of an image. So this is going to tell you the density. You can read these. Okay, so now the most important thing which we are going to understand is seismic waves. They are the most important sources available to understand the layered structure of the earth. The velocity of the seismic wave changes as they travel through different materials with elasticity and density. So basically, this is seismic waves are basically waves. Whenever the wave travels, you can help to know, you can get to know the nature of materials through which it has traveled. So because it is not possible for us to travel to the depth of the earth, but waves can do that. So, and we know that waves require a medium to travel. So when the elasticity and density of the material is high, the velocity of these waves will be high. They also go reflection and refraction as they come across materials with different densities. So as soon as there will be a change in density, for example, from solid earth, when they reach to the ocean, their speed will change because their behavior is based on elasticity and density of the material through which they are traveling. So they, as soon as the nature of the material changes, their speed will also change, because we have seen here that more elastic and more denser the material, higher is the velocity. Earth's interior structure can be understood by analyzing the patterns of reflection, refraction, and change in velocity of these speeds. So basically, the basic nature of these waves, we have understood that they will change their direction, they will either reflect or refract. So basically, reflection means hitting and coming back. Refraction is basically change in direction. So this is, I'm telling you technique for the non-science students, there is a basic difference between reflection and refraction. But we only have to understand the difference, that is, there is a change in direction. Second is the change in velocity. So we are observing these waves with the help of machines. And as soon as the direction of the wave changes, the machine changes a reading. So we can get to know, okay, so this must be the density here because the speed has changed. So density of this place is higher or density of this place is lower. All of this data can be today can be known with the help of computers. Now, so we will read more regarding these seismic waves, and the next sources are meteorites. Meteorites and earth are born from the same cloud, thus they are likely to have a similar internal. I'm extremely sorry. So meteorites and earth are born from the same nebular cloud, and they are likely to have a similar internal structure. So as I have told you that all of the things in the solar system are born from the same nebular cloud, so it will have a similar internal structure. And when meteoroids fall on the earth, their outer layer is burnt due to extreme friction and inner core is exposed. So as soon as the inner core of the meteoroid is exposed, so we can also come to know what will be the inner structure of the earth. They have heavy material composition, and this confirms the similar composition of the inner core of the Earth. Now, gravitation. Gravitation differs according to the mass of the material. The uneven distribution of the mass within the Earth influences this value. Such a difference is known as gravitation anomaly. Gravitation anomalies gives us information regarding the distribution of mass in the crust of the Earth. So basically, there is a change in the mass of the Earth due to basic change in the gravity of the Earth due to changes in the mass. Now, the magnetic field, the geodynamo effect. So geodynamo means geo is Earth, dynamo is basically magnetic behavior by shown by the Earth. It helps the scientists to understand what is happening inside the Earth's core. Shift in the magnetic field also provide clues to the inaccessible iron core. So basically, we cannot go deep, but we can understand that if any change is happening in the magnetic field of the Earth, then definitely there is some changes going on in the Earth's core. Now, sources of Earth's heat. First is a radioactive decay. The high temperature below the crust is due to disintegration of radioactive substances. Basically, we all know that the Earth also has some radioactive substances in it, because you can find radium, thorium, uranium, all of these radioactive substances on the surface of the Earth at times. So we know that these substances disintegrate and decay, and this heats the Earth. The nuclear decay happens primarily in the crust and the mantle. Now, scientists believe that uranium could be sufficiently concentrated at the base of the Earth's mantle to ignite self-sustained nuclear fission as in a human-made reactor. So basically what is happening is that there is in the Earth's mantle there is uranium and the heat is extremely high. So it forms a self-ignited nuclear fission reaction. So basically if uranium's isotopes are there and the heat is more in the surroundings, they become reactive, radioactive, and they start emitting heat. So this is the same thing that is happening in the Earth's interior. The new measurement suggests that the radioactive decay provides more than half of the Earth's total heat. Now, nuclear fusion does not occur inside the Earth, because for nuclear fusion there is a lot more heat and pressure required. So, and the Earth is not massive enough to take care of such situation, to cause such situations. So basically, in a nuclear fission and nuclear fusion, is in nuclear fission what happens is one molecule or element, you can understand it in basic things, that one element is splitting into two parts, so that is generating heat. But in fusion what happens is two atoms are combining and they are generating heat in the process. So what happens is when you have to fuse, so fusion means fusing together, so in fusion you have to fuse them together or mix them together, so that requires a lot more energy to continue. So that much heat is not there, but this heat, you know, is available on the sun. So in the sun what happens is nuclear fusion takes place, on the Earth nuclear fission takes place. Now, another source of heat on the Earth is primordial heat. Now, when the Earth was formed, at that time there was huge amount of heat released into the solar system. So there is still some that of heat left in the interior of the Earth. So this is known as the primordial heat. So it is written, the rest of the heat left over from the Earth's formation is known as primordial heat. It is the kinetic energy transferred by the Earth by external impacts of comets and meteors and subsequent effects, and latent heat of crystallization released by the core solidified. So basically all the effects, it is telling you in technical language, but the subsequent heating and cooling of the Earth, the formation of the Earth after the Big Bang and all of those things, so that heat after the Big Bang is basically still left in the interior of the Earth. So this is known as the primordial heat. Another source of heat for the Earth is tidal friction. The ocean tides are not only effect of tidal forces, So basically, the gravitational influence of the moon and the sun, they are explained in oceanography. We will study in the oceanography. So tide is basically rise and fall in the level of ocean, and that is because of the gravitational pull of the sun and the moon. The solid body of the earth also bulges slightly in this way. We will also see that the daily flexing of the earth and cause of loss of energies of the earth rotation is due to friction. The energy goes into heat, leading to increase in the earth's internal temperature. The loss of rotational energy means that the earth is slowing down in its rotation rate. So basically you see in this that due to the tidal friction and rotation, because of its placement in the solar system, it is rotating, and there is also loss of energy in this. So because there is a loss of energy, it shows that the earth is slowly slowing down in its rotation speed. Now, seismic waves. Seismic waves relating to earthquake or other vibrations of the earth and its crust. The above seismic waves which we have talked about, they are general. They are talking in general. Now they are talking about those waves which are relating to earthquake or vibration in the earth. These are naturally produced. Seismic waves are waves of energy that travel through the earth's layers and are, as a result, earthquake, volcanic eruptions, magma movement, large landslides and large human-made explosions. So basically, when you notice an earthquake, there will be a vibration. Vibration means fast movement. You will notice that your furniture is moving very fast. So they have an associated wave with it. So the refraction or reflection of these waves is used for the research into the structure of the earth's interior. The term seismic waves and earthquake waves are often used interchangeably. How are these waves produced? Now basically, the abrupt release of energy along a fault, basically sharp break in the crustal layer. So this line which you are seeing is a break in the earth's crust. Crust is basically, you can say, the earth's surface. There is a sharp break in this layer because there is some disturbances. Now when this break is there and there is some movement between these two parts or some movement anyhow, then there is an energy released. This abrupt release of energy causes earthquake. Now rock layers along the fault tend to move in the opposite directions due to the force exerted on them, but are held in place by counteracting frictional forces exerted by the overlying rock structure. So basically what it is trying to say is this is the fault and this part is trying to go this in this direction, that is below, which the arrow is indicating, and the this on the left hand side, this is going on the upward direction. So this causes a movement, but this movement is hindered by the frictional forces within these two blocks. So these two blocks, their molecules would be combined within each other. So as soon as they start moving, so this friction which stops them from moving and the force which drags them to other sides, this causes the release of abrupt energy. This causes an earthquake. Now the pressure on the rock layers builds up over a period and overcomes the frictional force. So initially you see there is no movement because of friction. Now as soon as there is movement, when the frictional force is overcome, this results in sudden movement generating waves which travel in all directions. So basically this circle is the point where this wave is being generated, and from here it will travel in all the directions. The point where energy is released is called the focus or the hypocenter. So this point in the interior of the earth, this is the focus or the hypocenter. Above the earth, this is known as the epicenter. The point on the surface directly above the focus is called epicenter. And an instrument which is needed to study these waves is seismograph. So seismic waves are studied through seismograph. Now types of seismic waves or earthquake waves. Seismic waves or earthquake waves are two types, body wave and surface wave. So body waves are those which will travel in the body of the earth, and surface waves are those which will be traveling on the surface of the earth. We will see how these happen. Now body waves are generated due to release of energy and move in all directions. traveling through the interior of the earth, hence the name body waves. So they are called body waves because they are moving within the body of the earth. They have not yet come out to the surface, and they are of two types. One is the P wave and the second is the S wave. Now P waves or the primary waves are longitudinal in nature and propagate. Wave propagation is similar to sound wave. So you have to understand that P wave or primary wave is analogous to sound wave, and S wave or secondary wave is similar to the ripples on surface of water. So basically, when you see that, so I'll explain it afterwards. First, we should see some issues of the waves. Now, primary waves or P waves, they are called primary because they are the fastest wave among the seismic and are the first to be recorded. So in the prelims, they can ask you in a true and false statement, which is the first wave to be recorded on the seismograph? The option will be primary wave. Second is, they are also called P waves because they are longitudinal, because the displacement of the medium is in the same direction or the opposite direction to the direction of propagation of the wave. So basically, if you compare it with a S wave or secondary wave or transverse wave, what happens in P wave is that if it is moving in horizontal direction, then the movement in the object will also occur horizontally. For example, if this is the object, okay, and this is the wave which is going, so this will move it like this. So the wave is coming like this and it is striking me, and the object is basically moving in the same direction or the opposite. So this is the direction of the wave, then it is moving back. So this is the primary wave. But what happens in the case of secondary wave is, just for example, you throw it in a stone in water, the disturbance is going in the vertical fashion, but the water is moving in the vertical horizontal direction. So in the primary wave, what happens is that it is behaving like a sound wave. It is longitudinal and primary because it is in the same direction, so it is parallel to the movement of the wave. They are called compression wave because they produce compression and rarefaction when traveling through a medium, and they are also called as pressure wave because they increase or decrease the pressure in the medium. P wave create density differences in the material, leading to stretching and squeezing of the material. So basically, when it is traveling like this, you will see that this is moving like this, but actually what happens is it is pressed like this and open like this. So it is pressed like this and open like this. So the effect on the material will be that it will be compressed and open. So like this, you can see in the image that the particles in this, they will be the particles of the object, they will be first grouped at one place, then there will be gaps. So this is the vibration and the direction of particles. Another features are that they are high frequency and the least destructive. So you have to underline these things. You have to remember that it is the first to reach, secondly it is the least destructive, and the motion is in the parallel direction. So either it is in the same direction or in the opposite direction. Now the trembling on the earth surface caused due to these waves in the up down direction, so vertical direction. Up down direction because they are coming from the interior of the earth. So if you look at this in this manner, this is the earth in the round shape and this is the wave which is coming, so it will move it like this. They can travel in all mediums, so basically they can travel in solid, liquid and gas, and their velocity depends on the elasticity or shear strength of the medium. So you will have to learn these terms. And the velocity of the P waves is highest in solids, then in liquids and then in gases. So they will be slowest in gases and fastest in solid. They take the form of sound waves when they enter the atmosphere. P wave is in the range of velocity is 5 to 8 kilometers. The precise speed kilometer per second. The precise speed varies according to the region of the earth's interior, that is from less than 6 kilometer in the earth's crust to 13.5 kilometer in the lower mantle and 13 kilometer per second through the earth's inner core. basically we usually say that the speed of the sound wave depends on the density, but there are exceptions. Mercury is denser than iron, but it is less elastic. Hence, the speed of sound in iron is greater than that of mercury. So basically, they have written here shear strength and not density. In most of the materials, you will study that the speed of sound or speed of wave is dependent on the density of the object. So that is not technically correct. Though if in options, if they ask you, it is depending on density and shear strength is not mentioned, then you will mark density. If shear strength is also mentioned, you will tick shear strength. Okay. Now, why do P waves travel faster than S waves? P waves are 1.7 times faster. P waves are compression waves and apply a force in the direction of propagation, hence transmit their energy easily. So basically we have seen that in the P waves what happens is that the direction of their movement and the direction of the movement of the object through which they are traveling is the same. So there is a little less disturbance. But in the S waves what is happening is these are transverse or shear waves. The motion of the medium is perpendicular to the direction and hence they are less easily transmitted through the medium. Now, P waves as an earthquake warning. Now, advanced earthquake warning is possible by detecting non-destructive P waves. So basically, if you attach seismographs on the earth's surface, so you can get a reasonable amount of time to prepare for the next dangerous wave which is coming up. So advanced earthquake warning is possible by detecting the non-destructive primary waves that travel more quickly than the destructive secondary and surface waves. Depending on the depth of focus of the earthquake, the delay between the arrival of P wave could take about 60 to 90 seconds. So basically at maximum, the warning which you can get for the earthquake is 1 to 2 minutes. Now what happens is in secondary waves. Now secondary waves are recorded second on the seismograph and are also called transverse or shear waves. So you can directly get a question on the difference between these S waves and the P waves, or you can also be asked the properties of these waves individually, either in prelims or mains. There is a limited chance, but you must be prepared. They are analogous to the water ripples. So transverse wave or shear wave mean that the direction of vibration is perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. Hence they create troughs and crests in the material through which they pass. We will see the image also. S waves arrive at the surface after the P waves. So these are high frequency and slightly higher destructive power. The trembling of the earth's surface caused due to these wave is side to side. So basically on the surface of the earth what will happen is, so basically we know that this is the interior of the earth, the S wave will come like this and it will cause a shaking like this. So the P wave will shake the surface of the earth like this, upside down, basically up to down, and the S wave will shake the surface of the earth like this. So on the whole, the cumulative effect of the earthquake is going to be very devastating. The trembling on the earth's surface caused due to these waves from side to side, basically horizontal. S waves cannot pass through fluids. Basically, they can only pass through solids. So unlike the P waves, this is a major point of difference that they cannot pass through liquid and gases and do not support shear stress. They travel at varying speeds through solid part of the earth. So basically when the speed, now the next thing is surface waves or L waves. What happens in these cases is the body waves interact with the surface of the rocks and generate a new set of waves called surface waves. So now what happens in this case is as soon as the these wave, S wave and basically the body waves, S and P waves have come on the surface of the earth, they travel on the surface of the rocks and they create more waves. So basically when these rocks break down on the surface of the earth, they themselves will also generate more shock waves. So these shock waves represent a disturbance, and when these waves will come on the surface of the earth, they will cause a lot of disturbance. When the body waves come on the surface of the earth, they are bound to form a disturbance, and the rocks, huge rocks on the surface of the earth, they may get damaged, and because of that new waves will develop and they only travel on the surface of the earth. So these are known as surface waves or L waves. So we have known three types of waves: P, S and L. P is primary, S is secondary, and L wave is surface wave. Now they interact with the surface of the rock and generate new set of waves called surface waves. They are also called as long waves. They move only along the surface. They are also called long period waves because of their long wavelength. They are low frequency waves and they develop in the immediate neighborhood of the epicenter and affect only the surface of the earth. They lose energy more slowly with distance than the body waves because they travel only across the surface. Now, particle motion is larger than that of the body waves and are more destructive. Basically, they are the most destructive. Even though they are the slowest, but they are slowest and are recorded last on the seismograph. So first we will record the P wave, then the S wave, and then the L wave. So basically, I think there is an image also which I showed you. See this. This is the first reading on the seismograph, which is a P wave. Then there is an S wave, which is coming at the second number. And then we have the surface wave. Now look at the energy in this wave. This is the highest and this is the most destructive. So they are the slowest and the last to be recorded on the seismograph, which we have studied with the help of image. Now these surface waves are also divided into two. These are Love and Rayleigh. Now it is the fastest surface wave and moves the ground from side to side. Now Rayleigh waves, they roll along the ground just like waves roll across a lake or an ocean. So Love waves will move like this and the Rayleigh waves will move like this in a spiral motion. Because the Rayleigh waves move, it moves the ground up and down and side to side at the same time, in the same direction in which the wave is moving. Most of the shaking and the damage from the earth is due to Rayleigh waves. Now this is an important point for you to remember, that most of the shaking and the damage is done with the help of Rayleigh waves. So basically these are the body waves. Then this is the S waves and P waves. So P wave is moving the earth in up down fashion. See, because P wave is coming from the interior and traveling upwards like this, and it is, see, the disturbance is also moving like this. But in the case of S wave, the disturbance is moving from left to right, left, right, left, right. So this is the kind of disturbance created by P and S wave. But the surface wave will move like this. This is the disturbance created by L wave or Love wave, and Rayleigh wave will create this kind of a motion. So the Rayleigh wave will create the most harmful kind of problems for human beings. Now how do these waves help us in understanding the earth's interior? So now seismic waves get recorded in the seismograph. Difference in their arrival times, taking different paths than expected, and absence of seismic waves in certain regions is called as shadow zones. So basically when you will see, we will see the readings in the seismographs which are attached in different parts of the earth. At some points we see that they have arrived in different times interval. Probably if the earthquake is somewhere located in Himalaya, so the wave will travel at a different speed to Uttarakhand and at a different speed to Delhi. So there will be a different time at which, so basically the speed will be the same, but the time will be different because of distance. And second thing is that some waves will be recorded only in Uttarakhand, some will only be recorded at Delhi. So this will tell us what is the difference in the structure of the earth. So now discontinuity in velocity are indicating in the composition and density. So because there is a change in speed of the wave. At every different place, we can get these readings and we can find out the speed of the wave. So when we study the speed of the wave at the point where which we have got the seismograph, then we get to know that the speed of the wave is different in different places. So what's happening in this cases is, we get to know this because the density of the places will be different. And I told you in the beginning that the speed of the wave will be dependent on the density. So the place where the speed is high, it means the density of the interior of the earth is higher, because more density will lead to more speed. Now, discontinuity in the velocity will tell you the changes in composition and density. That is, by observing changes in velocity, the density composition of the earth's interior can be estimated. Discontinuity in wave motion are indicating in the change of phase. So basically, we can see in which phase the wave is traveling, what has happened. So we will observe the changes in the direction of the wave and emergence of the shadow zones, and different layers can be identified. So basically, the waves are behaving in a particular manner in when they are traveling in one phase of the earth. As soon as they change, that density is changed abruptly, their speed will also be changed. So that will be reflected in the computer. So as soon as this position where the wave is changing its direction or the speed, we can find out what changes are there in the earth's structure. Now, emergence of shadow zones of P waves and S waves. We already know that S waves do not travel through liquids. The entire zone beyond 103 degrees does not receive S waves. We will see now what this is saying. So now basically, if the earthquake is happening at this place, S wave will not take place after 103 degrees. S wave will not be visible after 103 degrees. Okay. This is the primary wave shadow zone and this is the S wave shadow zone. So you can be directly asked the question in explaining the shadow zones in mains. You will have to make this diagram and you will have to write down all the points which are beginning from this place. Emergence of shadow zone in P waves and S waves. So you are required to pay attention on this point. This is a direct question for mains. S waves do not travel through liquids. So firstly, you will write down something about P waves and S waves. First down, write down that P waves and S waves are both body waves. Because they are body waves, they travel through the internal structure of the earth and they help us to know the internal structure. Now, P waves can travel through solid, liquid and gases. S waves do not travel. So, S waves do not travel through liquids and the entire zone beyond 103 degrees does not receive S waves. And hence, it is identified as the shadow zone of S waves. So, basically, all of this area is a shadow zone of the S wave. So basically what we come to know is that because the S wave is not traveling after this point, so we know that this area must be a liquid. Okay, so we have got to know our first indirect assessment of the internal structure of the earth. So it is showing the liquid outer core of the earth. So we have got to know that the outer core of the earth is in liquid form because S waves cannot travel. Now the shadow zone of P waves appear as a band around 103 and 142 away from the epicenter. So basically this is the P wave epicenter and this is not visible from this portion to this portion. We will study why this is happening now. This is because P waves are refracted when they pass through the semi-solid mantle and the liquid outer core. However, the seismograph located beyond 142 record the arrival of P waves but not of S waves. This gives a clue about the solid inner core. So basically what is happening in this case is the S wave, P wave is coming here, it is still able to travel in the core. So you can see this is visible here. It is not going to this area because the speed becomes slower at this point. So it is directly going from this point to this point because of decreased speed. And then again the speed increases and it increases its area of coverage. So the 103 degrees to 142 degrees is not covered by the P wave. On the other hand, this area beyond 103 degrees is not covered by the S waves. So a zone between 103 degrees and 142 degrees is identified as the shadow zone for both. So basically, if someone is asking you if 103 degree to 142 degrees is the shadow zone of P wave only, then it will be wrong, because S wave is also not appearing in this case. Okay. The seismograph located at any distance within 103 from the epicenter record arrival of both P and S waves. So basically, if there is a seismograph from any area, in any area up to 103 degrees from the epicenter, that will record the coming of P wave and S wave. So basically, this is a physics topic. This is extra information. You can read it on your own. So now, with the help of the waves, we have studied the internal structure of the Earth. So we can find out the Earth is broken up into several layers. So this is the innermost part, and it is inner core. It is solid. Then there is the outer core, the area which is covering this part. It is known as outer core. It is a liquid. Now, why both of these things are called as core? Because the elements which are making the core are same, but it is solid inside and liquid outside. Then there is mantle, and then there is the crust. See, this is outermost layer is the crust, and so rest of the things we are to ignore at this point. Now, the interior of the Earth is made up of several concentric layers, of which the Earth's crust, the mantle, outer core, and the inner core are significant because of their properties. The crust is a silicate solid, basically made up of silica. The mantle is a viscous molten rock. Viscous means that which is not flowing very easily, not fluid. Opposite of fluid is viscous. The outer core is viscous liquid, and the inner core is a dense solid. So basically, you have to remember these things, and this will give you a better picture. So if you look at the Earth like a pizza slice, then the innermost part is the inner core, and from 5100 to roughly 6400 kilometer. If you can draw this diagram in the exam, it will be extremely beneficial for you to score more marks. So this is an extremely important diagram. So only we are available to only this much portion, only 12 kilometer deep we have dug till now, and so rest of this portion below this point where the mouse is placed right now, all of the rest of the information has been gathered with the help of these seismic waves. So the properties of the seismic waves, their comparison, all the types of seismic waves, so all of these are potential questions because they are of high relevance in the geographical portion. So there is the inner core, outer core, mantle, and this asthenosphere. The asthenosphere is basically, we will study this in detail, the lithosphere, crust, mantle, all of these things are coming up in detail. So the Earth layer can be divided into lithosphere, asthenosphere, mesospheric mantle, that is the Earth below the lithosphere and asthenosphere, outer core and inner core. Chemically, it is the crust, upper mantle, lower mantle, outer core and inner core. So mechanically, they are saying different, because mechanically means due to the movements which have been detected. So this will be more important when we will be studying the tectonic movements of the Earth. So basically, lithosphere, asthenosphere, mantle and core, when we are studying the movement of the tectonic plates. But when we are studying the chemical composition of the Earth, we will be studying this. So initially, we will be studying crust, upper mantle, lower mantle, and outer core and inner core. So basically, crust is the outermost layer of the Earth, basically making 1% of the Earth volume and less than 1% of the Earth's mass. Density increases with depth. The thickness varies, basically 50 to 70 in the case of continental crust. So basically, in the regions where there are mountains, you will see that the size of this outermost layer is going to be very high. But where there are deepest oceans, there you will see that the outermost covering of the Earth is the thinnest. The continental crust can be thicker in 70 km in major mountain systems. It is as much as 70 to 100 km thick in the Himalayan region. The temperature of the crust increases with depth and reaching values in the range of 200 degrees to 400. Basically, when it reaches the mantle, it can also reach up to 200 degrees. The temperature increases by 30 degrees for every kilometer. The outer covering is made up of sedimentary material, and below that lie the crystalline, igneous and metamorphic rocks, which are acidic in nature. The lower layer of the crust consists of basaltic and ultra-basaltic rocks, ultra-basic rocks. So basically, upper layer we have seen that it is having sedimentary, then crystalline, igneous and metamorphic, which are acidic, and then we are saying that they are basaltic and ultra-basic rocks. The continents are composed of lighter silicates. So we have seen that it is a silicate in composition. We studied this earlier. So they are silica and aluminium in the continent part. Whereas in the ocean part, oceanic part, the crust has basically below the ocean, the earth surface or the seabed, that will have silica and magnesium. They are also called as SEMA. This classification was given by Edward Suez. He called this as SEMA and CL. It is out of, this is obsolete now. This is out of date. And this is given in the NCRTs. So if you read it from there, I've just made a passing reference to it because it is not required anymore and it is wrong. So it is technically and factually wrong. You are not suggested to write this in your examination. Just mention it if you want to. Now the continental crust, so basically this is the real thing about continental crust. It is known as felsic. Felsic why? Because sodium, potassium, aluminium and silicate rocks are there, like granite. So basically the continental crust is made up of granite. You can understand it this way. And the oceanic crust is made of dense mafic. Mafic means iron and magnesium silicate rocks like basalt. So in geology, felsic means igneous rocks that are relatively rich in elements of feldspar and quartz. And it is contrasted with mafic rocks, which are rich in magnesium and iron. Felsic refers to rocks which are lighter elements like silicon, oxygen, aluminium, sodium and potassium. Now the abundant elements in the earth's crust is oxygen, silicon, aluminium and iron. You have to learn it, not in terms of percentage, but in the order. So this is the same thing. So calcium, you must remember 4 to 5. Then this is the same thing given in terms of pie chart. Now within the earth, the composition is different. Within the earth, you will find that on the whole, iron is the most abundant, oxygen takes the second place. But in the crust, you can see the oxygen is taking the first place and iron is at the fourth place. So you can be asked this in a very confusing manner in a prelims MCQ, or you must understand this also. Now Morovicic discontinuity. It is the basically crust and the asthenosphere. So uppermost part of the mantle is known as asthenosphere. So this disturbance, as soon as the properties of the earth will change, we have known it because of changes in the movement of the wave. So as soon as the wave, P wave, reaches from the crust to the asthenosphere, there is a change in direction because of change in velocity. All of these things will be noticed in the computer, that the wave has changed its direction, wave is changing its velocity. So this is known as a discontinuity. Discontinuity means discontinuity in the nature of the earth and discontinuity in the nature of wave also. So the first discontinuity is known as Mohorovicic discontinuity. It is the boundary between the crust and the asthenosphere. So this is a discontinuity in the seismic velocity. It occurs at an average depth of 8 kilometers below the ocean and 30 kilometers below the earth, continents. So basically we see that there is a change in the rock composition from feldspar to rocks that contain no feldspar. So basically rocks above the Mohorovicic will contain feldspar. Lithosphere. Lithosphere is the rigid outer part of the Earth, varying 10 to 200 kilometers. It includes crust and the upper part of the mantle. The lithosphere is broken into tectonic plates. So basically, I told you when we study the mechanical part of the Earth, mechanic movement of the Earth, the lithosphere and the asthenosphere, all of these things become important. So what is happening in this is the crust and the uppermost part of the mantle, this will be tectonic. This will be known as the lithosphere. And this lithosphere in itself is broken into many tectonic plates. And the movement are the basic cause of the changes in Earth's structure. The source of heat that drives plate tectonic is the primordial heat left over from the planet formation, as well as the radioactive decay of uranium, thorium, potassium in the Earth's crust and mantle. I had told you what primordial heat is. Primordial heat is basically the heat which is left over from the formation of the Earth. Now, mantle. After the crust, we have the mantle. It forms 83% of the Earth's volume and holds 67% of the mass. It extends from the Mohawk discontinuity to 2900 kilometers. So this density is not extremely important, but the lower mantle extends beyond the asthenosphere. So it is a solid state. It is in a solid state. So now basically the lower mantle, which is solid in state, it is below the asthenosphere. The mantle is composed of silicate rocks that are rich in iron and magnesium, that are related to the overlying crust, so they are more denser. Now mantle is made of 45% oxygen, 21% silicon and 23% magnesium. In the mantle, the temperature is basically 200 from the crust boundary and 4000 at the core boundary. Because of the temperature difference, there is also convective material circulation in the mantle. So basically, I told you that there is the Earth's magnetic field due to convection current in the mantle. So because there is some molten materials also there due to very high temperature in the mantle, so they convect around. So basically, you must have studied convection in your class 6 and 7. Convection is basically in a liquid, that the when you start heating a liquid from below, the particles of the liquid heat and rise upward and they send down the cooler ones, and this is how the circular motion begins. So this is known as convection. Convection is expressed at the surface through motion of tectonic plates. High pressure conditions inhibit the seismicity in the mantle. However, in subduction zone, earthquakes are observed even in the mantle. Now, asthenosphere. The upper portion of the mantle is called asthenosphere. Astheno means it is weak. It is just below the lithosphere. So lithosphere is basically the crust, and it is highly viscous. Viscous means dense liquid, mechanically weak and ductile. It is extremely weak mechanically. It is not very strong. For example, mechanically strong means iron. Mechanically weak means it has less physical strength. But its density is higher than the crust. These aid in the plate tectonic movement and the isostatic adjustment. So basically, isostatic adjustments is not important. This is important for those who are taking geography optional. But what happens in the isostatic adjustment is that due to the relative changes in the weight of the Earth, for example, if there is a mountain range which comes up on the surface of the Earth, and on the other part of the Earth there is a deep valley, so then the place where there is a mountain coming up, that will be heavier than the valley, so the Earth will try to adjust its balance again. It will find a new center of mass. That is known as isostasy. So now asthenosphere is the main source of magma that finds its way during the volcanic eruptions. Now outer core. Outer core, which is surrounding the inner core, lies between 2900 km to 5100 km. The outer core is composed of iron mixed with nickel and is not under enough pressure to be solid. So because the pressure is less here, it is not solid, hence it is liquid. Even though it has a composition which is similar to the inner core, the pressure is so less that it becomes liquid. So now the dynamo theory suggests that the convection in the outer core combined with the Coriolis effect give rise to the Earth's magnetic field. So basically the I give you the wrong information. The convection in the mantle is responsible for the movement in the plates and the tectonics. It is not for the Earth's magnetic field. So this outer core, when it moves, I am extremely sorry, see, because it is having iron and nickel. Iron moves, iron has a positive charge in it, it moves and it creates a magnetic field. What happens in the inner core is that it extends from the center of the Earth to the below the Earth's surface. The inner core is believed to be iron and nickel. Since this layer can transmit shear waves, it is solid. When P waves strike the outer core, they give rise to S waves. So Earth's inner core rotates slightly faster related to the surface. The solid inner core is too hot to hold a permanent magnetic field, so there is no magnetic effect from the solid inner core, and the density of the core ranges from this much. So it is 16% of the Earth's volume but 33% of the Earth's mass. So density is very high here. So the temperature is, they are saying that it must be around 600 degrees Celsius, that is much high. Now this is as high as the sun's surface, this temperature, but the crushing pressure, basically a lot of pressure is coming from the overlying weight of the Earth, that prevents from becoming a liquid. Now seismic discontinuity, so we are just telling you the discontinuity. One is the Mohorovicic discontinuity, which separates the crust from the mantle. Asthenosphere is the weak, mechanically weak and ductile part of the mantle. And Gutenberg discontinuity is between the mantle and the outer core. So these three discontinuities you have to remember. Now the next thing which we are to study is the Earth's magnetic field. Now a field is a region in which a body experiences a force. Gravitational fields is basically relating to mass of the body. In electric field there is charge, but in magnetic field is basically how moving electric charges exert force on another electric currents. So now how is this generated and sustained? Dynamo theory proposes that Earth or a star generates magnetic field because convection in the outer cores, outer core. In the Earth, I told you that the outer core is liquid and combined with the Coriolis effect. So Coriolis effect is the effect which is caused due to the rotation of the Earth. Because the Earth is moving, when something is moving in the north hemisphere, it will be deflected towards its right. So this we will, Coriolis force we will study in detail when we will move towards the planetary winds. So the you have to only understand this, that the convection in the outer core and the Coriolis force give rise to the magnetic field. We know that there is lower pressure than the inner core and it is fluid. The temperature is very hot and the heat is due to uranium, potassium, primordial heat, and so basically all of those things, these are just repetitions. So because of this, the difference in the temperature, pressure and composition within the outer core cause convection currents in the molten iron or of the outer core as cool and dense matter sinks while warm and less dense rises. So basically when you have studied convection in water, that the lower particles of water which are near the heat source, they rise upwards. So this is similar to that, but it is happening with the help of iron in this case, because core is predominantly made up of iron. So this iron is heated and its convection takes place. This generates an electric current, and this electric current produces a magnetic field. The charred metal passing through these fields go on to create electric currents, and so the cycle continues. So this is known as geodynamo. The spiral movement of the charged particle caused by the Coriolis force means that the separate magnetic field created are aligned in the same direction, their combined effect adding up to produce one vast magnetic field of the planet. So basically this is what is happening in the core. It is convection is happening and this is produced. Now the next part is the magnetic poles. So basically you know the North Pole, geographical North Pole and geographic South Pole. So magnetic pole is not the same. Basically magnetic's North Pole is thought as the pole attracted by the Earth's magnetic North Pole when the magnet is suspended, so it can turn freely. So when you have a magnet, its North Pole is that which is attracted by the magnetic North Pole of the Earth. When you have a magnet and you keep it in a free situation on the Earth, so that pole of the magnet which will be attracted to the North Pole of the Earth will be called as North. Since opposite poles attract, the North magnetic pole of the Earth is the South Pole of the magnetic field. So basically when you will have a magnet, it will align itself in North-South position. So this is what we write when we study magnets. So when the magnet is there, the upper end is known as North, but that is actually the South Pole of the Earth's magnetic field. Magnetic dipole field, basically the magnetic field, is fairly close to the geographic poles, and which is why a compass works. However, the dipole part of the field reverses after a few thousand years, causing the location of North and South magnetic poles to switch. So basically after some million years, some thousands or millions years, you will find that the Earth's magnetic field has reversed itself due to some changes in the core or some convectional current changes. It is a continuous process. So at that time we find a lot of biodiversity being wiped out, because these are extremely important for the birds and animals which migrate. Their blood reacts to the poles, so they may die due to lack of information. Now geomagnetic reversal in the Earth's magnetic field, that the position of the magnetic North and magnetic South are interchanged, so this is known as the geomagnetic reversal. So based on paleomagnetism means old, and magnetism means magnetism. So the old magnetism, the records of which we have today. So magnetism in basically when you have a rock, it will also have crystals in it, and they will be aligned according to the Earth's magnetic field. So we have found in very old rocks which were millions of years old, we can see that there is a pattern in those rocks that their alignment of the particles have been changing. So this is known as paleomagnetism. It is observed that over the last 20 million years, magnetic North and South have flipped roughly every 2 lakh years to 3 lakh years. So in the Sun, it is so accurate that it is happening every 11 years, but this is not the same as in Earth, but it happens. Could be about a few hundred to few thousand years. The magnetic pole emerges at odd latitudes throughout the process of reversals. Now normal and reverse field. So normal is basically what is happening today. When the reverse field will be there, it will something like this will happen on the surface of the Earth. The Earth's field has an alternate between periods of normal polarity and the reverse polarity. The normal polarity, so the Earth's North magnetic pole is the South pole of the magnetic field. So this is the normal polarity when the S of the magnetic field of the Earth is this, in the North direction. Now, current location of the magnetic poles. North and south magnetic poles shift towards due to the changes in Earth's magnetic field, and they lie about this range. Okay, so this is the longitude or coordinates of that position. They lie north of the Ellesmere Island in North Canada and is rapidly shifting towards Siberia. And the south magnetic pole is off the coast of Antarctica, even outside Antarctic Circle. And it is changing, so it is not important to learn the exact point because it is changing 10 kilometers every year and its speed is accelerating. So basically this is all of the rest of the information is not specifically important for the examination. So but this you can just go through. They have never been asked, but this may be. Magnetic declination is the angle between the magnetic north and the true north. So probably if the magnetic north pole is in this direction, we will calculate it with the north pole of the earth and we will notice its difference. Now magnetic inclination or dip, angle made with the horizontal by the earth's magnetic field. So basically horizontal is this line, magnetic equator and the equator, this difference will be known as the dip and all of those things. So you can read this through and you will get to know. Now geomagnetic poles. Geomagnetic pole or the dipole are intersection of the earth's surface and the axis of the bar of a magnet hypothetically placed at the center of the earth. So approximately it is tilted at an angle of 11 degrees. So if you will place this magnet here at the center of the earth, you will find that this difference is of 11 degrees. So this is also extra information. And, magnetosphere also we will study in detail in the layers of the atmosphere. But see, this is the region beyond the ionosphere. So basically this is the space, it is the extent of the earth's magnetic field in space. It extends several tens of thousands kilometers into space, protecting the earth from the charged particle from the solar wind and cosmic rays, which would otherwise strip away the earth from the atmosphere, including the ozone layer. So whenever there is a solar storm, that storm reaches the earth. So whenever that storm reaches the earth, it can rip apart the atmosphere of the earth. So this magnetosphere protects us. So Joe Kovila is saying that, can we get the PDF? So that PDF is already shared in the Telegram group and channel. You can join the Telegram group by clicking on the link in the description. I have already shared these notes. So for those of you who are new to the channel, we also have a test series going on and today is the test day, so you can register for the test series as well in the channel. Now magnetopause is the point where this basically is this magnetic field of the earth is distorted by the solar wind, and the solar wind exerts a pressure. The magnetopause is where the is the area where the pressure balances. So basically the outermost part of the magnetosphere which we are reading, this outermost layer is known as the magnetopause. All of these things are just extra information. This is required if you have geography optional. So but this auroras which we have here is extremely important. So now this is name given to the luminous glow. Probably you can search it in the YouTube, and you will, if you will see these videos, these are one of the most beautiful features of the earth. It is something, these are colorful radiant lights which you see at the north pole and the south pole. Do check out a video of this, and it is extremely beautiful. It is one of the most beautiful phenomena to happen on the earth. It is the name given to the luminous glow in the upper atmosphere which is produced by charged particles. So when the solar wind is coming, it is charged, and it comes and hits the earth's magnetosphere. So due to that there is a glow in the atmosphere. It is very beautiful, and these positive ions drift westward and negative ion drift eastwards, giving to a ring current. So basically it strikes and the charges split up. So these form an electric current and this gives a glowing effect. However, this reduces the magnetic field at the Earth's surface, which can be very dangerous. Some of these particles penetrate and collide with the atoms there. This results in excitation of oxygen and nitrogen molecular electrons. So basically you just have to understand that it reacts with oxygen and nitrogen and get back to the original state by emitting light. So they follow the magnetic field lines. So basically this flow of light will happen in such a manner that the magnetic field line of the Earth is displayed. So it is very beautiful, and they occur in high altitude. So this is how these so this is actually a photo. So it is stopped, this aurora is stopped. When it is happening in the North Pole or the South Pole, it is constantly moving. This movement or this circular type of thing which you can see is extremely so this round movement is always present in this. Okay, so you can find more information like these. So what are the effects of these storms? So the varying condition in the they are known, they are driven by solar activity. So as soon as there is a storm on the sun, this is what happens. So if the solar wind is weak, the magnetosphere expands, and if it is strong, it compresses the magnetosphere. So the period of intense activity called as geomagnetic storm can occur. Coronal mass ejections are there. So corona is the outermost part of the sun, and when a lot of heat is exited from that portion, then they send shock waves in the solar system. It takes 2 days to reach the Earth, and at the Earth's surface a magnetic storm is seen as a rapid drop in the Earth's magnetic field strength. So ring current, basically I told you the same thing which was happening there. The effect which happens here is the ionosphere gets heated and distorted, and long range radio communication cannot take place. Then basically satellite drags is increased, so controlling the satellite in the outer space is also difficult. Astronaut and high altitude pilots also face high radiation levels, and electric grid can also fail, and they also cause a problem in satellite communication and GPS. So if there is a major solar storm, all of these systems are wiped out. And soon every day, a few days or another, you will be hearing such news or articles that there is going to be a major solar storm which is going to take place, and communication and technology as we know on the surface of the Earth will never be known again. So all of these things are there. So there are movies also based on this concept, but we do not have to worry about this a lot. Now Van Allen radiation belt is a zone of charged particles captured and held by a planet in the planetary magnetic field. So basically these are charged particles which are held within the magnetic field. So only that you have to understand. And this is endangering the satellites. So basically this is giving you an information about magnetic field of other solar system. So this is also not very important. The major part of the syllabus, which will which is the geomorphic movements, it is of extreme importance. So now from this point onwards, you must be paying a lot of attention. So this is the main thing which is asked. So initially we studied the S waves and the P waves, their difference and the structure of the Earth. So that is the main important part there. Then auroras can also be asked. Then this we have to study. Geomorphic movements. So today we will only cover their introduction, and we will stop the class in 2 to 3 more pages. So geomorphic movements are Earth's crust and its surface are constantly changing due to forces which are endogenic or exogenic. So those which are coming from below the Earth and those from outside the Earth. These cause physical and chemical changes. Some of these are slow For example, weathering, some are extremely gradual, that is, they will happen over some time, and then which are sudden. So geomorphic basically means those which are relating to the formation of landscape and features of the earth. Now geomorphic agents are mobile medium, like running water, moving ice, basically which bring a change in the structure of the earth. And processes are physical and chemical processes which bring about the change. So endogenetic are those movements which are brought down by forces emanating from the deep below. So we have discussed endogenic and exogenic, and the forces are also discussed again here. Earth's internal heat, convectional current and density changes, radioactive decay and primordial heat. So we have discussed this. The classification of endogenetic movements we can study here. So basically earth movements are either endogenetic or exogenetic. Endogenetic are known as diastrophism and exogenetic are weathering or erosion. So we will see all of them in detail. Epirogenic means continent forming, and orogenic or are known as mountain forming. So what happens is, and epirogenic is when a continent is formed, it is known as epirogenic endogenic movement. When a mountain is built, it is known as orogenic movement. Sudden movements are earthquake and volcanoes. All the slow movements are due to exogenetic forces. So you can use the term endogenetic or endogenic interchangeably. So we will study rest of the part from here tomorrow. And if you have any doubts, I know this is a bit complicated for you, but if you will revise this, it will be very clear. So I'll be stopping the class here. If you have any doubts, you can ask, or you can ask in the Telegram group also. Okay, thank you so much.